All right, so we're here at the CIM convention in Montreal, au Palais des Congrès, with Vic Pakalnis.
Hi.
And so it is Sunday, May 10th, Mother's Day, and we're going to start our interview. So to begin, just some quick basic questions. So here we go. So could you please state your full name?
So Victor Vitatis Pakalnis. I was born in Malartic in 1950. Malartic was the gold mining capital of the world. It had something like 40 operating mines in that area. It was just an incredible mining camp. After the war, there were a lot of immigrants that came over, including my father, who came over from Lithuania. He was a civil engineer back in the old country, but they didn't need civil engineers, they needed mining engineers. So he naturally said he was a mining engineer, and after some time in the surveying department, he became the engineer and the chief engineer and ended up in various mining camps. So I have a history of mining.
Excellent, excellent. You can, just by the way, you can converse with me just so that.
You want me to point
you? Yeah, just us having the conversation.
Sure.
You talking more than me, of course, but yeah, just us two.
Alrighty.
Could you please state your age and also the date you were born?
So I was born on June 29th, 1950, and I'm just about 65.
Excellent. And you had stated where you were born and what your
right.
parents had
so
done.
So my parents were immigrants that came to Canada after the war, and the government of Canada recruited a lot of immigrants for the mining industry. And so a lot of the mining camps like Malartic and Sudbury and various other ones across the country had a lot of immigrant population, Polish, Ukrainian, Lithuanian, all of the different countries were represented, yeah.
And you as a child, because you grew up right in the middle of it, essentially.
Absolutely. I was born in Malartic and
In mining, essentially.
I was born in mining, and in those days there was some houses that were given to the the people that ran the mine. My father, being a mining engineer, as I mentioned, he was trained as a civil engineer, but did convert to a mining engineer. Because that's what they needed. So, I was born in a house downtown Malartic, and moved to a house that now is where a huge open pit is. The Osisko mine is mining the remnants of all of that basin. It's going to be the largest open pit gold mine in Canada, and. Where I lived is no longer there. They moved the entire town over, and where my house was is part of the pit.
It's almost symbolic.
It is. It is. Just there's a lot of symbolism in mining, as you'll see later.
And as a child, what did you do to pass the time?
So it was interesting. I had a lot of French-speaking friends. Playing on the streets. Je parlais français sur les rues. I spoke Lithuanian at home with my parents, and then they put me in English school. So I was at Renault Public School, and in fact they put me in when I was 5 years old. The plan was that I was supposed to fail. Just learn how to speak English, right? Because I didn't speak a word of English before I was 5 years old. But darn, I went and got great marks in that, so they had to promote me to the
so you're good with
second
languages.
Year. Sorry?
You're good with languages.
Well, all my buddies spoke French, so obviously you learn how to speak French very easily. And I guess every so often my father would move, and it was part of mining. Basically, after 3 to 5 years, either the ore ran out in a mine, or because of the mining legislation of the day, they a lot of mines had a tax-free period of 3 years. So they would high grade the ore and then close it, move on, and it was tax free. It was until they caught up with that scam, and there was quite a bit of quite a few mines that ran that way. But he worked in the Malartic area. He worked up in Chapay, which is near Chibougamau, up Miska mine. He was a chief mining engineer in those different places. He also worked in Cadillac, which was south of Malartic. He worked in the Kirkland Lake area. My first job when I was a teenager, still in high school, was at in a crusher house, working with the conveyor belts and cleaning the spillage and a variety of jobs that that frankly got me into the mining industry in a practical way. Summer jobs I did up in northern Quebec, a place called La Belle-sur-Quivion. I was going to school at McGill. McGill had a great mining school. It was the best in the world at one point. It was giants were teaching there, the greatest, one of the greatest fathers of rock mechanics, Professor Morrison, and people like Don Coates, who wrote the definitive work back then on rock mechanics. It was a very heady time, and in the summer, I went off to make money, and it was very lucrative. Mining engineers, mining students back then were just the cat's meow. We could get jobs any old place. I mean, it was just amazing. And I worked for Kratos on exploration, and we would do a magnetometer, electromagnetometer, gravimetric surveys, do layouts, laying out the diamond drill holes and things like that. And even though I was a very young guy, I remember I started when I was 5, so I ended up as party chief. Wow. I ended up as a party chief. I had about 20 people there, and the reason I ended up as a party chief because I could contour maps, you know. Like I was the only
map guy.
Anybody could, yeah, so it was interesting that just a simple skill, you know, like you do all the work like everybody else during the day, but then in the evening, I didn't mind doing all the contours, and then we'd set up where the drilling sites were and all that sort of thing.
How old were you at that point?
Well,
that's
a good point. It was 17 years old. Uh-huh. Yeah, 17 years old. So you can imagine, 17, 18, 19, so it was 3 summers. And working with some exceptional people, absolutely exceptional. Dale Henricks was the head of the Kratos and Exploration Group. I think he's still kicking around in the business exploration. He had a good intuition in terms of where the gold was, and we did find actually some gold deposits up there, but they were too small. And somebody should get back there and. Because remember, in those days, gold was $35 an ounce. Now it's over 1,000, right? So what was profitable, you know, what was not profitable then could be profitable today. We found a lot of different deposits, but we were primarily chasing gold.
Was that what your father had done as well? Was he mostly
gold
mining?
My father went from gold mining to molybdenite to copper. To silver, different kinds of mining operations. Some large companies, some small companies. He did a lot of and he was also a prospector. He loved prospecting. One of my earliest recollections was going on his shoulders as a little kid, going through the bush staking. You have to blaze the trail from range line to range line to mark out your claim, and then you file the claim, and then it's yours for the year while you do some work on it, and if you discover something on that property, then you become rich. So he never became rich, but we had a lot of fun.
It was almost a hobby in a way as well.
It was a hobby too, and
like going fishing.
I grew up very fast because he decided that rather than my going on his shoulders or just following him, he'd send me out with a compass, blazing the trees myself. You know, of course today that would be child abuse, but in those days. Kids would do that with their fathers, and we did a lot of exploration together in northern Quebec and northern Ontario. I eventually ended up also working underground at Caradison Mine in Virginia Town, and I was a surveyor, but more interesting, I was also a miner's helper. I worked in a square set stope, which is a very, you use square set mining with posts and caps and beams and that sort of thing, where the ground is extremely, extremely broken up and difficult to manage. And I remember there was a Polish miner, and I was his helper, Stan. And Stan was came from Poland. He was, I think he actually was a professor in philosophy or something like that. Uh-huh. But obviously he didn't go into philosophy here, but he definitely, you know, we had some interesting discussions, and we spent a lot of good time together there, and then I obviously practiced a little of my engineering design stuff as well. Graduated McGill, worked at Iron Ore Company Canada, Shefferville, as a bank stability engineer. And
At McGill, what was your program exactly?
Mining engineering.
Mining engineering.
Yeah, it's mining engineering. And at the time, I think there were only 9 schools of mining across the country, and. There's some schools had been had closed down because of the mining industry. You should know, is a very cyclical industry. So the commodity prices go down, everybody's cutting back, and no jobs, that sort of thing. And then it goes booming, and then they're looking for more and more, and you know they can't get more, and it's a boom bust kind of an industry.
Because you were saying when you went to McGill, it was busy.
Yeah, it was busy. Yeah. We had lots of jobs, and I could get jobs anywhere, and I went to the Shefferville job. This was Iron Ore Company Canada. Brian Mulrooney was the chairman of the board, I think, and eventually closed that place down because even though it was a very high grade, 55% iron, it's a very high grade ore body. It was very costly because it was kind of removed. You had to ship the ore by train to Shefferville or to Sept-Îles, and a variety of different reasons. The commodity prices went down. Eventually, he did shut it down. It was an interesting community to live in. All mining camps are interesting communities to live in. I mentioned to you that Malartic and Val-d'Or and Rouen and Kirkland Lake and Sudbury as well are all built by immigrants. There was a huge immigrant population that came after the war and went up there. Shefferville, there are no roads into Shefferville. It was just that just the railroad that came in. So it was a very different kind of a setting. So everybody was from someplace else, and we had largest consumption of alcohol in Canada.
Oh, yeah?
At that one Régie d'alcool outfit.
We'll get to that. I'll ask you about that.
We had an interesting community center, and we'd all get there, and there's nothing to do, so you all participate in everything, you know. The one thing I really loved was the Northern Lights. Yes, you lie down and you just watch the Northern Lights. It was better than television.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Or computer games or anything like that. It was magical.
Luckily,
but it was pretty rustic, and I decided, yeah, I'm not sure if that's what I want for the rest of my life. So I decided to go to do a master's. So I did a master of engineering.
Still in your 20s at this
back,
point?
Yeah. That's right. And in those days, the federal government actually was quite generous in terms of its support of research. And they gave McGill $1 million. Can you imagine? They don't give $1 million now to across the country, but they had this grant to do permafrost research, and we built right from scratch a huge facility that still is there. It's on Mont Saint-Hilaire, the mountain there, big dome. If you look at it, that was my lab. And so we built it. We built the insides, walk-in freezers, and we shipped permafrost from Schefferville all the way to the Montreal airport. I'd pick it up in these big ice chests, bring it into the lab, put my parka on, and test the rock. All of the machinery was there for cutting diamond saws and everything like that. For cutting the rock, it was frozen soil, really. And you'd take that frozen soil, test it, and then thaw it out, reconstitute it, and test it again. So all the work that had been done in the United States and elsewhere was on reconstituted soils, frozen soils. This was actually the first time that there was natural permafrost that was being tested. And all of that was very interesting. I remember there was the U.S. Corps of Engineers that were hovering, and I was wondering, why would they be interested? And I found out it was for the design of treads on train vehicles and tanks and things like that in for warfare in the Arctic, that kind of application. And there was only two testing machines of the capacity that we had at McGill. One was in Norlitz, Russia, and I remember exchanging some information, you know, and testing techniques and things like that with a fellow investigator over there. It was still part of the Cold War, remember? There was a Cold War going on, and so we had to be careful of what we shared and what we didn't share, and it was scientific work that was useful for everybody. But anyway, I went from there, and I was thinking of doing my PhD. But I hated being a poor student. I really did not like being a poor student. It's just, so two companies gave me offers. One was Inco, and the other one was Falconbridge. And I ended up at Falconbridge. They were more persistent, you know, in terms of getting me in. I became the senior ground control engineer at Falconbridge. It was a wonderful company. It was an absolutely wonderful company. We had Falconbridge, of course, has a very storied history as well. Thomas Edison was up there, had invented some geotechnical equipment, and in fact, one of the shafts is named after Edison. He was an investor in mining operations, so he had come to Sudbury. So I spent I spent some time there, and there was a terrible tragedy that really changed the course of my life. Probably still would be with Falconbridge or its successors, but because I really love that company. But there was a terrible tragedy. There were five people, top executives, that were flying in from Toronto to Sudbury. And they hit an antenna at Barrie, and all went down, all perished. All of the president, the vice presidents of technology and HR, and it's coincidental that at this CIM I met Russ Buckland, who used to be the VP, his son is here, which was interesting that he'd still be in the business. And so we talked about his father. And it was, mining then was, and really, I guess it still is, it's a very insular group. We all know one another kind of thing, and we all have our pedigrees, you know, like where's your father from and what's this and what's that, you know. And so if you stay in the industry, you become more trusted. And of course, if you screw up, you basically are, you might as well get out and go sell shoes. But good people in mining tend to land on their feet in different parts of the world as well. It's a global industry. I ended up, because of an interesting set of circumstances, there was some miscommunication, and whenever there's a crisis, you have to be careful about communications. But there was a fellow that was recruiting for the Ministry of Labor. And I had never thought of working for the government. But this fellow was insistent. And things were a little shaky there at Falconbridge. So he phoned me. Sorry?
Why was it shaky?
Well, because we had lost all of our executive, and there was, you know, nobody knew where it was going, and the share prices were falling. There was some issues. One fellow that was put in charge, frankly, didn't communicate the plan as well as he should, and some of us were uncertain in terms of where our future would be. And he eventually got fired, and the company flourished after Gordon Slade took over. He's somebody you should interview. He lives in Sudbury, and he's very, very excellent mining person. I remember he came to my retirement party, a retirement going away party. Really great guy. He says, "Well, Vic, are you sure you want to go to government?" You know, like I says, "Well, I already gave them my word." You know, like. So he says, "Well, I'll work a year, and then after that, think again." But I spent 30 years in the Ministry of Labor. I was the chief mining engineer for the province. I really respected the fellow that recruited me. Ernie Isaacs was the chief mining engineer. He's since died, but...
So was he looking to find a replacement, or...?
I'm sorry?
He recruited you.
So he recruited me, and I came to the Ministry of Labor.
And did you take his place, or were you just...
I did.
Okay. So he recruited
At first, he recruited me not to take his place, but to be to rewrite the section on rock mechanics. I was a rock mechanics engineer, and he needed a rock man to talk about instrumentation and testing and all that kind of stuff. So I ended up as the ground control engineer, the first one that the province had. And... after he decides to go for the top job at another organization called MASHA, Mining Safety and Health, he recommended me for the job, and so I ended up as the chief mining engineer. And it was really interesting that very quickly I rose to be the director of the program, the youngest executive in the Ontario Public Service. That was an interesting story on all of its own. The fellow that was the director before me was a guy named Peter McCrodin. He came from Timmins. He was head of a number of mining companies. McIntyre mine was the last one he was at. They used to call him Pistol Pete. He always used very colorful language, as mining people do. He didn't suffer fools. He get on with it. What do you want to say? Boom, done. And Pete McCrodin basically gave me a really good mentorship, coaching, whatever experience before he retired. In fact, I remember going down to Toronto, and he had some encounters with various women executives, and he was a little bit leery about working with that gender. And he says, "You go talk to them. You go talk to them." He says, "Anytime I just blow up and then they start to cry. And he would say things like that. My gosh!" And I said, "Pete, you can't say that kind of stuff, you know." And I ended up working with the assistant deputy ministers and fairly high up individuals, and for a younger person. Well, of course you're going to work, and there were some very talented people that we had at the Ministry of Labor, and it was just excellent. At any rate, Pete McCrodin, when he left, had left a good legacy. I remember the interview for that job, which was historic. On that interview panel, the head honcho of the Ham Commission. This is the Royal Commission into Health and Safety in the Mining Industry. James Ham, Dr. James Ham himself sat on the interview panel. The executive director for the division wasn't a mining person, and he needed somebody that could understand the problems in mining.
I did some work on James Ham.
Did you?
For our, I think he was inducted this year. I'll have to double check, but this year I think he was inducted in our engineering and technology hall of fame.
Well, he is magnificent. He was the dean of engineering. He wrote an excellent number of books, frankly.
He was big on the health and safety a while
and
back. Right?
He was the author of the
commission.
Ham Commission.
Yeah. That was him.
And he also toured the North Country 10 years after his report came out. There were two other commissioners on it, but he was the principal one. I remember him working in the United States at the Brookings Institution to compare the American experience with ours. I remember bringing him around to various mining camps in Elliott Lake, for instance. They thought he was God. I mean, this is the guy that changed the history of health and safety, not only in Ontario and Canada. Before his report, mining had its own regulation. Construction had its own regulation. Occupational health was handled by the Ministry of Health. It was all scattered. There was nothing holding together. After his report, which dealt with mining, the government of the day, this is with Bill Davis as premier, and the deputy minister, Tim Armstrong, decided we needed a consolidated Occupational Health and Safety Act. And based on the recommendations of the Ham Commission, based on the ideas that came out of that report, internal responsibility systems, all of the roles and responsibilities of workers, supervisors, employers, everything, that went in as the law, not just for mining, but for every sector in Ontario. So you can imagine here is God sitting on your interview panel, you know? Anyway, it was an amazing interview. I remember the director of the HR group, and I knew some of the other people that were competing. In fact, one of them worked for me, and I ended up working for him later on. And I thought, well, this other guy is really much better. He's more polished and all this kind of stuff. At any rate, they picked me, and And so I became the director of the mining program, and I remember going in to see Tim Millard, and in those days the deputy minister had to appoint the executive, the director. And he says, "Yeah, Vic, I understand that you're successful. Congratulations." And he says, "You know, we look at the mining branch as a bit of a lightning rod." But he says, "The only problem is we're not sure whether the lightning rod is there to protect us or whether it attracts that lightning." Mining, anything that happened in mining always got front page coverage. Anything that happened in any other sector, yeah, 3-4 down and maybe it got covered. But mining, boy, anything happened, it always got coverage. And it also got lots of airtime in the legislature.
So
you had to worry. Well, there's something about the environment we're in. You know, we work miles underground. We're in a very strange environment that most people can't relate to. We had in those days the strongest unions going, much stronger than anything else in other industries. And in fact, in some ways, the reason we have the Occupational Health and Safety Act is because we had a very strong union, the Steelworkers of America, in Elliott Lake. And they just decided, they walked out, the illegal strike. And they stayed out until the legislature, and in those days, Bill Davis, of course, was the premier, and there were some very powerful opposition members that essentially debated, and then finally, we need a Royal Commission to look at why we have such high incidence of lung cancers, and the ventilation was not all that good in Elliott Lake. The safety standards were not all that good. And because of the Ham Commission, it was dramatic in terms of the fall in fatalities and lost time injuries. It's an incredible story, So with that as the backstop, here I come in, and I had it pretty good. We were the cat's meow. There were no better in the world than us. Our mine rescue handbook was being used by South Africa. They were buying thousands of copies because they used the Ontario standard in South Africa. We had an amazing talent in terms of engineering and in different areas, a working environment, electrical, mechanical. We had the only testing facility for wire ropes that other provinces would send to Ontario, and we would test ropes from other countries, Mongolia and elsewhere. And we had money as well, because when you get into trouble, people think, "Oh, let's throw a little bit of money, maybe we..." Well, we actually did reduce the accident rates, fatalities, lost time injuries, everything. And we trained our inspectors to actually help, not just enforce, but to help the industry.
Educate.
I had an amazing amount of money to train my mining inspectors. And it was the largest training program put on by the Ontario government. At the time, there was a lady named Rita Burak, who was the Assistant Deputy Minister for Finance at the Ministry of Labor. And she said, "I don't know if your hands are shaking, but mine are. This is the largest..." You know, it was pretty close to $1 million to train, and the way we sold it was not only to train our inspectors but also the industry. So it was a partnership with the MASHA, the organization that I mentioned, the former chief mines engineer went to head up. You know, so we. We made it happen, and it was a good time. We accidents were going down and everything. I ended up in a major commission of inquiry on the Ministry of Labor. There was some allegations of of impropriety that politicians were directing the public service to prosecute where they shouldn't prosecute or not prosecute where they should, that sort of thing. There were allegations, and we had something called a McKenzie-Laskin inquiry. And Bora Laskin's son actually was headed up the, and he became a Supreme Court judge in his own right. There was also the management side was analyzed quite significantly by McKenzie, and of the three divisions, there are three branches. There was construction, mining, and industrial. Mining looked great. We had training programs for all the inspectors. We had expertise, you know, technical expertise. We had all that kind of stuff. And unfortunately, the one that frankly had the largest bulk of workers reporting to it, industrial, didn't have as much resource put against it. So I went from an area where I had great comfort, and I could get the leadership back then, both on the labor side and the management side, were exceptional people to work with. Exceptional people. There were giants. There was Walter Kerlick from Inco. There was Henry Brejo. Dome, Placer Dome. There was Mike Sopko. There was Bill James from Falconbridge. These guys were incredible. And we had also a lot of technology being developed in the 80s. We had the Naranda Research Center here in Montreal. We had the Sheridan Park in Toronto. There was amazing discoveries. We mechanized most of the mining. Because of that Ham Commission, a lot of our innovation was driven to help make things safer. But at the same time as we're making things safer, we're making them more productive. So it was a win-win for everybody. So safer, productive mining. And then we hit a bit of a snag, and I'll get back to my my transition there I mentioned in the late 80s. In about 85, we had something called the Stevenson Report. It was because of a rock burst that hit Falconbridge, and four people were buried, three of them instantly, and one, unfortunately, we tried to get him out. He was alive for about a day and a half, I think it was. And we were digging. It was the first time mine rescue was used in a non-fire emergency. And we were using microseismic monitors to find out whether the place was safe for the rescuers and all that sort of thing. It was a story all on its own that's documented actually in the Stevenson Commission reports that should be in your library, because it's an interesting story. In that story, we moved the yardsticks. I was transitioning from being a chief mining engineer to the director, and we had four management representatives and a neutral chair. Trevor Stevenson was a mediator from the Ministry of Labor, so he kept the peace between the labor and management people, and I was his technical advisor, kept the thing going, and we had use of the premier's airplane going off to all the mining camps in Ontario. It was just an interesting time, and gathering information from workers, from technical people. We brought in experts in rock mechanics and all of the technology that we used. The report, frankly, was implemented most of it, not all of it, but most of it. And also there was a recommendation for mining research. And the province wanted to put in a chair in rock mechanics. And they funded it for $1 million. The industry said, well, perhaps we should put one in U of T and one in Queens as well. We have three mining schools in Ontario. And so the leadership in those days was brilliant. And they could see that having new knowledge being developed was something we needed for the industry. So it was Walter Kerlick, Henry Braho, and others that came up with the industry funding that doubled the amount that the Ontario government could put up. The fellow that headed up the unit in Sudbury at Laurentian University was Peter Kaiser, Dr. Peter Kaiser. He's raised more money than any other person in mining for research across Canada. The guy is amazing.
He should be here this weekend, I think.
Maybe.
I tried to call him, but
if he works for me still, by the way. Oh, okay. He's retired, but you know, he's a special advisor to the president. Yeah. So it is coincidental that after all of this, I end up being an organization now that I head up. I'm the president of MIRARCO Mining Innovations, that he started. He had his chair at Laurentian. He started a geotechnical group, GRC it was called, that eventually molded or morphed into MIRARCO. And he also started SEMI, which was another organization. And
I'm going to see their booth later.
Right, and Doug Morrison, the president of SEMI, is here too, so you can have a chat with him. Those 80s were an amazing time for technology, for innovation, research, the whole bit. And I kind of went from mining to industrial. So went from an industry that I knew really well, 20,000 people, industry and labor leaders that I could trust and I really respected, to 3.5 million workers, everything, you know, nuts and bolts. There was only construction, which is about 300,000. So there's mining, construction, and then everything is rest. And the way I cope with it is I built the mining model in the industrial. I figured it worked for me there. So I and don't ask me why, because you probably already can figure out the. But I took the 3.5 million workers and I put them into pots in industry sectors, 12 industry sectors, 12 apostles, you know. Yeah. Anyway, I decided, okay, auto sector, you know, petrochemical, you know, all the different sectors. And these days, I think they've broken it down to subsectors and everything, but I wanted to keep it simple back then. And part of it was that we built mechanisms that we started in mining, but now we had them in other sectors, like the healthcare sector. The healthcare sector has an advisory committee with labor and management from that sector advising the government on what should be done, what are the standards, how could we make sure that accidents are reduced in that sector. And the same for the firefighters, and same for the steel industry, and things like that. Well, mining had those mechanisms way before anybody else had. We had something called the Mining Legislative Review Committee that started with labor and management support, and any recommendations they would make, government would obviously think that's a great idea. And when you have the people that are going to be regulated that can give you, you know, a balanced view of things, and it's always government's final role to decide what to do, of course, but they would, having that mechanism makes sense. The other thing we had back then was regulated mining training programs, Common Core training. So not just for safety, but for doing the job, and safety was built into doing the job. The first industry that was regulated training-wise, mining. It's now being adopted in other sectors. So we had, it was pretty heady days in terms of how that was all rolling along. After 30 years in the mining industry, not the mining, sorry, labor. In the government, mm-hmm. after 30 years in government, I got an offer to come to Queen's as the Kinross Professor in Mining and Sustainability. And quite an honor, quite an honor. How that happened was that I was on loan from the Ontario government to the School of Policy Studies at Queen's. It was called the Amethyst Fellowship. So it's quite an honor to get because, you know, it's 1 year. The government donates it, and you teach. You're supposed to teach a course. I taught three in health and safety, in policy execution, and with a colleague of mine, project management. And we had, and I had a great time. Somebody from the mining department across the campus found out there was a mining engineer and he likes to teach. What are the chances? So after I went back to the Ministry of Labor, after my stint as the Amethyst Fellow, they came calling and I ended up as the Kinross Professor in mining and sustainability. So I taught a couple of courses, plus I started with colleagues from other departments, masters in applied sustainability. And did that. And then when it was an industry chair, so Kinross donated the money to support the chair. When that came due, somebody from Sudbury phones me up and says, "Did you check the Globe and Mail?" And they were advertising the position that I presently have. So 2.5 years ago, I thought, "Well, wouldn't it be nice to go back to my old haunts in Sudbury?" And I found what a lovely place. I loved it back then, but now everything's green. Everything's the air is cleaner than Ottawa or Toronto or even Kingston. The air is cleaner. Most Canadians think of Sudbury, you know, back in the 70s. It's not that way now. We've got 300 lakes and you can swim in them. 300 lakes in the city. It should be called a city of lakes, for gosh sakes. You know, I'm not sure if there's any other city in Canada that has 300 lakes. That was because of amalgamation mm-hmm. in the late 90s. Everything's green, the air is good. The food, amazing. They brought in a whole bunch of different ethnic restaurants, and I would put the top four restaurants in Sudbury against the top four in Kingston. They're that good. Huh? They don't have a Scotch club yet, but I'm working on that. But otherwise, I'm loving it. Sudbury is a great place. You know, we have a very interesting group of people that's very dedicated to mining research. Have 40 researchers that are working in energy, climate change, in geotechnical engineering, and safety, mining safety. And great plans for the future.
Right on. And as, like, this might be a tougher question, but as an individual yourself, what in your professional career, if you had to choose, would be you find to be your biggest accomplishment?
Biggest accomplishment?
Whether it be at the government or MIRARCO?
Probably my son. Yeah, having a son. I'll tell you, I think most fathers would say that, or most mothers probably would as well. Their kids, I mean, that's the biggest accomplishment. I remember dropping him off at school. learn lots, have fun. That was the motto I gave him. But professionally, I guess, you know, I had 30 years, so saw a lot of history
in the
public service, eh? When I was at Falconbridge, we designed some very interesting instruments that we never patented, basically, we just used. And but I'm just trying to think of, I think some of it has to do with the legislation that I drafted. I guess the Stevenson report, probably. I would probably say that's one of the ones I'm most proud of. Since I went to MIRARCO, we just finished a job for the Ministry of Labor on technology and the management of change, and I'm very proud of the work that was done there. I also, while I was with the Ontario government, I had some very interesting work that I did with the Secretary of Cabinet, Tony Dean, one of the greatest policy minds Canada's ever known. And we did some work on collaborative public services between Ontario and the federal government. And we restructured some of the services, so labor market stuff came over to Ontario, and other services went to the feds, and we designed these common counters that are peppered through the province. I was one of the founders on the Provincial Ministry Council, which is all the regional directors outside of Toronto. We seem to have a greater amount of energy to make change. So when I was the regional director for Eastern Ontario, we combined forces with the other regional directors from the other ministries, and we kind of figured, okay, how do we make things better for Eastern Ontario? And then we joined forces with other groups of regional directors from the other five regions of the province, and we created something called the Provincial Inter-Ministry Council. And it was the chairs of, you know, all of the units, so I was the chair of chairs, and we helped the government on some of the tougher assignments. When Mike Harris, for instance, came in and gave a challenge to Rita Burak, the Secretary of Cabinet at the time, that she had, that we had to downsize the public service from 86,000 people to 64,000. That's a heck of a job. And how do you keep a public service running while you're doing all this stuff, right? So we did it. It was a nasty job. I don't know if it was my proudest moment, but we did it. It was something, you know, public servants are not politically aligned. Unlike the United States, where everybody from director up is a political appointment, in Canada, deputy ministers and down are all professional, nonpartisan public service. So we give honest advice and loyal execution, and whoever the people elect democratically, we support them. So I think that time, that was a very difficult time for the public service, was I did my best work, because we kept the public service going. We in fact improved some of the metrics on service and accident rates, which we really worried about, because when you're going through all that, people's minds are off their work, right? We kept the accident rates down. So it was a trying, challenging time, but we made it happen, and that certainly was a proud moment too. That's a good question. I'm going to have to reflect on that.
Yeah, that's a tough question.
A little
give me
more.
A few to work with. That's good.
Anyway,
and maybe a bit more about your time in the private sector with the different mining companies.
Yeah.
But what were your social activities professionally, like, or with the other coworkers?
Well, you know, I I'm a professional engineer. So I know I wear my iron ring. I'm very proud of it. And I still volunteer with the Professional Engineers of Ontario, and I've been involved with Canadian Engineering Accreditation Board. You know, we make sure that the various universities have good standards in terms of their engineering departments. And there's always an element of fun to, you know, everything we do. Like CIM, for instance, we're here at the CIM conference. There's all the galas, the evenings. It's wonderful to see people that you haven't seen for a year, or sometimes longer. I mean, some people I haven't seen for 10, 20 years, and they figure I'm still, you know, like, I had never left Falconbridge, you know, like, whoa. I run into some very good people that I knew back then, and trying to tell them where my life went, and some of them stayed put, but most of them ended up in different countries, Indonesia and South Africa and South America and this way and that way, but they tend to come home after a certain time. I enjoy philosophy. So in Sudbury, we had something called the Teilhard Group, Sudbury Teilhard Group. And it was Teilhard de Chardin was a philosopher, and we had the largest Teilhard group in Canada, actually in the North America, and we would invite speakers from all over the place. You know that Sudbury, there's something special about Sudbury, isn't it? I mean, 1.38 billion years ago, there's this meteorite that hits to mark the spot of where Sudbury's going to be, right? I mean, hey, right now, SNOWLAB, which is where they're searching for dark matter. It's called the SNOWLAB is got 7 or 8 experiments on the go to figure out the origins of the universe. 13.8 billion years ago, the universe is born. And we haven't got a clue what happened the second before this, you know, like, yeah. And the discovery of dark matter will happen in Sudbury. And it's in a mine, Creighton Mine. So before I left Sudbury, they were just planning this thing. Now it's incredible. Stephen Hawking has already been there a couple times. And the experiments that they're doing now, I'm sure within the next 5 years, they're going to discover the origins of the universe. And it's all happening in a mining town in Sudbury. Yeah.
Neat.
So Scotch Club is a...
Scotch.
You asked about social.
Yeah, sure. Like, yeah, social.
Well, what, mining so people absolutely like beer, any kind of beer, and Scotch.
And Scotch.
Scotch is special, you know. I remember when I was at Queen's, I gave lectures on networking, because you got to be a good networker to succeed in mining. And I always said, you know, a good cup of coffee, that's all you need, really. You know, you want to talk to somebody, say, hey, how about a cup of coffee? Well, sure, you know, what harm can come? And then you get a relationship built with a cup of coffee. And I said, if you really want to close the deal, Scotch in the evening. You know? So we have, I joined a Scotch club in Kingston years ago now. And I still belong to it. I still go back every 2 months to Kingston to keep my membership up. Nobody quits there. You have to die or whatever, but you don't leave that Scotch club. It's so hard to get into, you know. It's a very limited number of seats in that. It's at the Kingston Brew Pub in the top flight, and it's limited on the room size. So I'm trying to start one in Sudbury. I figure that's neat. The place to. And it's not going to be just mining people. It's going to be others as well, because of course we have to unite with the rest of the world and society and all that sort of thing. Miners, unfortunately, it's a strength and our weakness. We tend to stick together. We're very insular. We just kind of protect one another. We hate media people because they always come up with some nasty, you know, thing. And we have legacies that unfortunately we didn't cause. Today is a very different time than a year, 100 years ago. A lot of the legacy issues are being cleaned up, like the Laurel, for instance, just near Belleville. It's where gold was first discovered. But they left behind an awful mess. Well, it's being cleaned up. It's going to cost something like $50-80 million. And it's going to be cleaned up. And there's also Camp Kosha up in Timmins. There's Steep Rock. There's different places where the legacy issues have given mining a bad name.
Tarnished.
And we have legislation now that you can't even start a mine until you have a closure plan, until you guarantee financially that you're going to clean it up, that you're going to reclaim it so that it can be used for other reasons, you know. So I think we have to sell the story, we have to tell the story of why mining is so important to the economy of this country, that mining people are really good, down-to-earth types that really want to contribute. We are the largest employer of First Nations, of any sector. You go down Young Street, University, hospitals, lots of hospital buildings are named after giants of the mining industry. York University has the Schulich School of Business. Pierre Lassonde has donated money to the University of Toronto and to various hospitals. Ned Goodman has donated an amazing amount of money. We're not supposed to say how much. An amazing amount of money to Laurentian University for the Goodman School of Mines, and also for the School of Business, actually, at Brock University. Mining people are generous people, and they come out and they help, and there's a lot of countries that, frankly, the only way they're going to get out of poverty is if they develop the resources properly. So we have to get outside of our little insert and tell our story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, this is hopefully a start. You had mentioned it's the largest employer of First Nations.
Yeah,
which is good. You can compare it today, but think of your whole career.
Yeah,
The presence of women. How absent or present were they?
All right. So embarrassingly enough, we actually outlawed women from underground. There was a law against having women underground. Believe it or not.
When was that?
And that comes from England. And in early times, women and children were used to do the hardest labor in coal mines. And at some point, people were so upset at it that they said, no more women and children in mining.
Do you know why it was... why it was like that in the first place? Was it because they're smaller? Or?
Remember Dickens' time, the poorhouses, and they're smaller. Like children, obviously, can get into, yeah. and women were more
finessy.
Yeah, they're not as clumsy, let's say. Any rate, for some reason, there was a myth that women were bad luck in mines. And how that, you know, perpetuated into North America, anyway, it ended up in our mining laws. And believe it or not, we had it. Till I think the 50s. Wow. Yeah. And then the Queen comes to visit Sudbury. Well, guess what? The law changed. Women, of course, are allowed underground, and they make some of the best workers. Like, for instance, on driving scoop trams and things like that, they're far better dexterity, and they're more careful not to drive into the walls. They make better workers. I shouldn't say that. It's sexist. But women in some minds are well accepted, and you know, we have lots of them. Not so much in others. It depends on the mining company as well. The more progressive ones, no problem. In fact, we have a lot of women foremen, a lot of women mining. When I started mining, I think there was one at McGill. And she ended up in a desk job in head office. When I was teaching at Queen's, it was about 30% were women. Now that was a high number. Not as high as, say, the legal profession or the medical profession. They have more women than men, mm-hmm. legal and medical profession. Engineering is still, unfortunately, hasn't caught up to those other professions. It depends on the school, but it's between 30 and 35, that area. Chemical engineering is 50-50. Chemical engineering has managed to integrate women, and they're great engineers. The top engineer at University of Manitoba was a woman, and First Nation as well. And so we have to get away from some of these silly restrictions that we have placed in the past, and a lot of them are just cultural. We have to just get over it. I think the younger generation is, you know, just not into that, and they treat everyone the same, and we've got quite a generational change from when I was going through university to when I was teaching just 3 years ago. You know, things like Engineers Without Borders, trying to help other countries and things like that. A lot more socially responsible kinds of activities. The whole respect for the environment, I think, is basic to engineering now. So I think it's all good. Yeah, it's all good.
It's getting better and better.
Yep.
Good. I know you have to go soon, right?
Soon.
Yeah. Okay. So here we'll try to finish.
Sure.
Right up here. This is probably one of my favorite questions.
Sure.
That I like to ask. If you had to, well, not even pretend. If you had to talk to someone much younger, like myself or mm-hmm. students, actually mm-hmm. you've taught, what would be the most important life lesson you could give them, or piece of advice?
Well, I think. You have to be true to yourself. You have to make sure you know what you want. I've had some students, they finish mining engineering, and then they come to me and say, you know, thank you very much and all this, and I tell them, where are you going? Well, actually, I'm going to go teach kindergarten. You went through engineering, and you went through mining engineering, which is, you know, to teach kindergarten? Yeah, I did it for my father, you know, he wanted me to be an engineer, but I really don't want to be an engineer. I want to be a teacher. I said, you know, it's sad. So be true to yourself. Make sure you know what you want. And if you want adventure, if you want challenge, world travel, there's no job like it. Mining can give you so much. But you have to want it. You have to make sure that that's in your, you know, in your DNA. You want to be in that industry. You have to have patience. Remember, I said the mining cycles go, and sometimes if you're hitting the bottom, you may find it a little harder to get a job. You may have to go a little further afield to get the job, maybe in another country. But you will get a job. Good people are always hard to find. So I think also make sure you network properly. Don't do it ad hoc. Build a strategy. Even as students, in second year when I was doing Introduction to Mining, I had them all come up with business cards. So they all had their business, you know, and they had the little Queen's logo on it, and they had, you know, they went to Staples and they got the business card. material, and they put their names and their email addresses, and when they give them to an employer, you know, or somebody that might be able to be part of their network, so the person had that and would put it in either a pile, or in my case, I have the business card holder. I've got 40,000 names in there, and now they've got these electronic business card sorters, a lot simpler, but I'm old school, so I still keep my stupid business card holder. So build up a network. Integrity is so important, and the world is small. So be careful the decisions you make. Sometimes it'll catch up to you if it's the wrong one. Also, if it's the right one and somehow something happens to you, something better will happen later. But integrity is something to be safeguarded. Yeah.
Thank you. And is there anything else you'd like to add or share with me?
Mining has been very good to me. It's a great profession. It's a great industry. It needs all kinds of people, accountants, lawyers, even historians. We need the history told of how this country was born. The railway story is amazing, but the mining stories are even better.
And they have a lot of similarities, I find.
Absolutely. The technology that's been developed, the mechanization side of things, and the importance to the country. Mining built this country, and it's still building it. And we have to make sure that we realize that mining is a base, is at the base of this country. We have to make sure we cherish it. The whole North Country still has an immense wealth. When I was going through McGill, all the mining schools were teaching us that there's no diamonds in this country. It's just impossible to have diamonds. Well, there's a lot of diamond mines now, as you know. The techniques that we're using haven't even, you know, the geophysical techniques and the exploration techniques haven't even got 10% of the wealth that's there. You know, we find huge gold mines right beside the highway running from Sault Ste. Marie to Thunder Bay, just beside it. I mean, so there's a lot of wealth, and Canada needs to develop its north. It's good for the First Nations. There was a national chief of the Assembly of First Nations, Sean Atleo, one of the greatest leaders I've ever met. Basically said, it's going to be mining and energy that's going to take the First Nations out of poverty. And they have to get good at it. They have to train themselves as business people, as engineers, help build that foundation that this country is based on. So I'm very optimistic, and I'm seeing good things happening, and it was a great industry to be part of. And thanks for the interview.
Well, thank you very much for your time.
Made me relive a lot of moments that I hadn't thought about for a while.
I'm glad.